You're not going to go, Jeff. You're going to stay right here. I won't let you kill yourself.
I love the way in which Howard Hawks was able to work within the Hollywood tradition. But the way he was able to tease it and mock it at the same time, I find that very intriguing in him.
Jeff!
He treats the genres the way his people treat each other. There are very few straight, level, uninflected relationships in Hawks. Always there's an edge, there's an undertone. And I think he has that feeling of edge towards the genre and the stories he's telling at the same time.
Eva Portman!
He needed a hit when he did Only Angels Have Wings. Bringing Up Baby, we should remember, was a big flop in its time. And it's the film just before this one. So I think he was trying to get back to something that would function more directly, an adventure film. The location is Barranca. It's a view of South America that is based upon the fact that hardly anyone had been to South America in those days, didn't know what it was like at all, and didn't really care. You know, there's a certain kind of narrative imperialism contained in the film. And yet the thing is done with such faith in fantasy and story and conviction in it that you don't object to it.
Calling Barranca. Calling Barranca.
Barranca, we see it nearly always by night. It's got the romance of a remote, exotic place, a place we will never go to, a place probably we could never find. It's in the Legion of Rick's place in Casablanca. I think for the American audience of 1939, this was a beautiful, fanciful location where straight away you feel, well, it might be fun to be there. That is the classic feeling of a Hawks film.
Oh, I carry only the best, eh, boys?
The jailhouse in Rio Bravo. Oh, God, I'd love to be there with them. The weird Los Angeles that you get in The Big Sleep. The cantina in To Have and Have Not. These are places where you just want to be. I wanted to be on the cattle drive in Red River. And I did not want the cattle drive to end. I wanted them to go on and on, having adventures. It's that kind of a world, but it's very well furnished with supporting characters or bit part players. It's a team that you want to be part of. And Hawks is very, very good on that sort of team spirit always. Hawks is a little unusual for his time in that he really loved to film groups. He is a master of that kind of full shot where you see maybe the whole figure and you see four or five or more of them together. The composition, the grouping, is a tribute to that team spirit feeling.
Joe, stand by. Tech says it's clearing.
Oh, no, not me, Papa. Less lost. I'm having dinner with Miss Lee. Miss Lee, Mr. Carter.
How do you do?
Hello, Miss Lee.
Bonnie Lee is the outsider. It is through her wonderment and bewilderment that we begin to appreciate the strange but intense cult among these men. And she thinks it's cruel, and she thinks it's ugly even. But she will learn, you know. And in the end, of course, she will really want to be a part of the group herself.
Oh, Joe, be careful. No chances. You
remember what I told you. Oh, now, Dutchie, you ought to find something to worry about.
Yeah?
The first grand passage of the film is one in which you don't quite know how to handle the whole Joe situation, because Joe seems like a brave, gutsy, funny guy who's doing a romantic thing. And bang, it's disaster. You think, well, they're gonna be devastated. They're gonna feel as bad as I feel watching it. But no, the guys don't let you into that. They say, you've got to ignore it. Now, you ignore it in a very studied way, and it's another version of heroism to ignore it, but it's an unexpected response. The dynamic goes beyond anything we anticipated.
What's the matter with you? He was sitting here with us talking and laughing just a few minutes ago, and now he's...
to mother and tell her there's no other...
You...
And then if you're into that kind of interplay of comedy and drama, who expects the film suddenly to become a musical? It's this feeling he had that Hollywood uses so many different genres all the time, and you can actually go from one to the other in a trice. You can be making a different kind of film, and it can all fit together. Now, not many other people knew that or dared it or tried it, but he knew you could. And for him, he had to do it, because it's really what he's about.
Oh, kid, how is it out there?
Everything's all right.
Yeah? Come on, let's get a drink.
Male friendship in his films is a hugely important thing. It's the ideal of a group of men who will be together on a job, which they do because they love it and because they have great skill at it, and they'll do it for next to nothing because the comradeship is probably the best thing they're ever gonna get in life.
Hey, Baldy, send over some drinks, will you?
Right. It's 1939. We are about to enter into a period of history where exactly this kind of male team spirit will be required. It's the version of the army at war where the guys are there because they know they have to be, because they know they're good at it, and because they've got a fighting chance that they're gonna come through.
I told you, Joe just wasn't good enough. If he hadn't got it tonight, he was bound to get it sooner or later.
Jeff's attitude to courage is a pretty tough code. And Joe fails it. And Jeff refuses to be touched or sympathetic about it, although Hawks lets us know that secretly he is.
Here's all the stuff that was turned in. I gave his clothes to the men on the field.
But he won't show it, because it's part of the male team that if somebody screws up, they screw up. Someone will replace them. As far as Cary Grant is concerned, Hawks was, like Hitchcock, enormously appreciative of the glamour of the man, the handsomeness, the way he talked. But just as he saw the charm in Grant, he saw a darkness, which a lot of directors never saw at all. And, you know, in films like Notorious and in this, you get a very tough, dark side to Grant, even a mean spirit sometimes. And I think that if you look at Grant's career as a whole, it's remarkable how those two directors, arguably the best two directors he ever worked with, saw into him. Now, if you show Only Angels Have Wings to people now, it's very difficult for a young audience knowing something about Grant not to see him as a gay figure. The way he dresses in the film, the sombrero, the shirts, the pants tucked up and everything, it's almost as if something in Grant was begging to come out. And Hawks was very masculine in his own life. Nobody who had known Hawks would ever accuse him of having a gay side to him or a gay aspect to the way he viewed the world.
Where's your map?
I don't like that stuff, Jeff.
Who does?
This can't help it. You know me. I'll do anything else.
I know.
Only Angels Have Wings is an important film in the sense that he had not really explored the male group in quite this depth and in quite this romantic way before. The bonding between the men is exceptional and unusual, and it's there all the time. And I think he was secretly very interested in the idea that there might be a love between men, or a trust between men, that is more enduring than the trust between men and women. The relationship between men maybe lasts longer.
Say, kid,
it's all right. You're not gonna do much flying with it.
You're crazy.
Yeah, I might try to move it.
Kid, you could say he's a father figure, and he is, but his relationship with Jeff is founded upon a vast array of unspoken things. Gesture in Hawks can be tiny, but he trusts the nature of film enough to know that that's going to be as expressive and as important as some very big action. He loves Jeff. There's no question about it. It's not there in the script, but it's in the way they look at each other. And you know, you can say this is just professional respect and fondness. And in 1939, that passed. Today, I think we know more about ourselves and we're more aware of complexities and different levels that are involved.
So long, kid.
I think there are two very, very important relationships for him that sort of have begun here. One is with the writer, Jules Furthman. He had worked with Furthman on one film before, Come and Get It. But Furthman, who was a brilliant story and dialogue man, had the same kind of darker inside that Hawks had. And you know, Furthman will go all the way through to Have and Have Not, The Big Sleep, Rio Bravo. He's there the whole way through. And this is the film, I think, where they really settle into their working relationship. The other is that in 1938, Hawks, who was then 42, I think, meets this fabulous 20-year-old, Nancy Gross, and they fall in love. She is the Hawksian woman. And I think it's almost as if Hawks didn't quite understand his ideal woman until he met Slim, because she was beautiful, she was classy, very smart, and she could talk back to him. She's a huge influence on Hawks, because the fact of the matter is, while he had worked through the 30s and been successful, from 1939 for 10 years, I believe he does his great work. And I think the women get smarter and tougher and bolder.
Hey, you're a queer duck.
So are you.
I can't make you out.
Same here. What was she like, anyway?
Who?
That girl that made you act the way you do.
A whole lot like you.
The stories about Hawks was that he would have pages of script, and he'd get on set, and what he liked to do was start playing around with it. And the famous stories are in which he says, well, okay, that sounds a little dull. Couldn't we liven that up a bit? And he encouraged a certain kind of improvisation, not with just one person, but really with the group. It's a group thing again. And he would egg people on, and I think that involved, it required smart actors. Jean Arthur had been a romantic actress, probably at this time best known for her work in Capra films. She was a more idealistic woman than Hawks was comfortable with, I think. In part because he wanted his women to be adjuncts to the men, but he wanted them ultimately to make the man look good. And I don't think Jean Arthur was quite in that vein, and that is probably to her credit, you know.
Oh, that's coffee.
She was more earnest, more genuine than he liked. I think he liked innuendo, understatement with overstatement, and the two fighting each other.
I don't care what your grandmother did.
And I think he liked the idea of scenes where characters would tease each other. The Rita Hayworth character is closer in looks and the way she bears herself to the Hawksian ideal.
Look what I want on the punch board. We'll make a nightcap out of it just as soon as I can find a corkscrew.
She had not had a serious acting challenge. And if you look at this film and you compare it to the films she had made already, not that many, her look changes. I think that someone who had been a very pretty Latin-looking woman before.
Hello, Jeff.
Hello, Judy.
Becomes a beautiful, not necessarily Latin woman. And I think Hawks has something to do with that.
Same old goo. You haven't changed a bit.
No.
Hawks was very, very good with people. He was very good at casting.
Go ahead.
Richard Barthelmess had been a big star. He goes back to the early 1920s, but he had fallen. And Hawks realizes he's got this role of very good role, in some ways the best role in the film. The man who has a reputation as being a coward, but is really a brave guy. I think that he wanted the slight quality of wound or being stricken that is in Barthelmess's face, because it's exactly right for the character who is trying to get over some terrible experience. And, you know, the way Barthelmess is photographed in the film, it's a very big part of it.
The kid asked me to buy you a drink.
Thanks.
Hawks was the kind of person who in life would not have wanted you to relax. He would have wanted you to be a little on edge, a little anxious that you were not going to miss the point. And part of that is that you play with expectations.
How do you like that? Heads on both sides.
Really? No kidding.
It's an attitude to life, which is to say that tragedy and comedy are never alone.
No wonder I've been buying you drinks all year.
I want to go with you, Papa. Please.
At the end, where Bonnie realizes the trick Jeff is playing with the coin, that was, I think, absolutely Hawksian thing.
Here, slip the coin for it. Tells you, go ahead, you stay.
That kind of mechanism, I think that was the way he liked to work. So he says, well, you think it's this kind of story. But, you know, this kind of story is a little dull if you just take it straight and seriously. So let's play with it.